now. That was so for the last years. And now we ask, is NPM still going on or is it passé? Many have argued that NPM is passé, no longer alive. We can argue about that, we can discuss that. But what has come in its place? Well, according to the first dimension, some people say there's more government now. Government is getting its proper place as a dominant actor in society back. Because of all the problems, the international threats, the financial crisis, in which it's said at least that there was too little control of government over the banking system. So government gets its place back. That's one thing. And the second dimension is that there is a return of emphasis on efficiency and output towards process and outcomes. That's the second trend, I see. But it's seen in different views. First, developmental state. For instance, in South Africa. You know, they say government should protect its domestic industry. It's not about attracting as many foreign investors as possible. You have key industry in your country, and government should protect that key industry. And that key industry should not strive for maximum profits, it should strive for maximum market shares, which is something different, in order to have as many employees as possible, to attract as many workers as possible, in order to avoid unemployment. You should have a strong key industry, and the government should ensure that. Should ensure that it is not taken over by foreign investors. That's the main thing of the developmental state. And they don't want capital transfer. It is not needed. So many foreign direct investment not needed in the developmental state, as it's seen in South Africa nowadays. And corporatism. Working together, government and market. Not leaving everything to the market, but working together with the market. It's a kind of partnership. And output legitimacy, effectiveness, is more important than input legitimacy, efficiency. And economic growth is more important than political and administrative reform. We need economic growth. That's the developmental state. That's one of the alternatives popular nowadays as a successor of new public management. And there you see it in the model. You see from market dominance, you see a trend towards mixed dominance, government and market doing it together, and not efficiency and output, but outcomes. Outcomes are the most important in that new developmental state. It's not how you do it. We don't care if you do it transparent or intransparent, no problem. Who cares anyway? Whether you are accountable or not, who cares? The only thing you care about is about the outcomes. What is good for society as a whole? That's the thing that's crucial in the developmental state. Not how you do it, not the process. Outcomes. Okay? That's one way to go. But still, the focus is on business, and there's hardly a role for the rest of civil society. There's public-private partnership, but limited to business. There's also the idea of the Neo-Iberian state, and Wolfgang Drexler, he's not yet here. I think his plane is also delayed, like my plane yesterday from China, arriving 1 hour late. But he's one of the supporters of the Neo-Iberian state. And it says, we need a reaffirmation of the role of the state as the main facilitator of solutions to the new emergent problems. Of a representative democracy as the legitimating element of administrative law in preserving the basic principles, and of the idea of a public service with a distinct status and culture, distinct from the private sector, really distinct. And that's classical Weberian, Max Weber, you know. And the neo elements are that there should be a shift from an internal towards an external orientation. consultation with and direct representation of citizens' view, a modernization of the relevant laws, and professionalization of the civil service. So what we see is that that model proposes to have a government that's dominant over society, a public sector that's dominant over society, but still efficiency and output as main emphasis. That's the main emphasis. And still, the main focus remains on the internal workings of government. Societal groups are mainly involved as customers to improve the performance of the public sector. Still. And then there's the total disappointment in new public management. You know, in Hungary is exemplary. Back to state control, do away with the free market. Back to the old communist system. Back to total control, the process and the outcomes are based and developed by government on its own. No role for civil society whatsoever. Civil society not included. And then what we see in Europe nowadays is enforced new public management because of the financial crisis. Further cutbacks, further privatization, further increase of the dominant role of the market, and simultaneously increased governmental control regulation over those banking systems, etc. There we see this. From a mixed system, we go to further market dominance. Because of the financial crisis, it's not affordable anymore. Still, there's nothing in it for civil society. And then we have the reaction in good governance. Outcomes-oriented, process-oriented. Government should do what it's supposed to do, to create security, to protect property rights, to reduce societal problems, and to take back its leading role in controlling and steering societal developments. But it's mainly process-oriented. Legitimacy and voice, direction, performance, accountability, fairness, rule of law. It's how you do it. You know, it's Ella Fitzgerald. It ain't what you do, it's the way that you do it. As if what you do doesn't matter. It's only how you do it that matters. Do it transparent, do it accountable. And I wonder, I always wonder, was Ella Fitzgerald right? I don't know. It ain't what you do, it's the way that you do it. I don't know if that's correct. I think outcomes are important also. You know, but this is really from mixed, from market dominance to mixed and process-oriented good governance. But there is a role for civil society. But the importance of civil society is buried under the amount of requirements good governance has to fulfill. I don't know, does any one of you know the World Governance Indicators as made by the World Bank? 160 indicators, at least. You know, they say six dimensions, but the dimension, the way they measure it, it's overwhelming. It's overwhelming. And civil society, the role of civil, it's only one of those indicators. So I'm not too happy. Second reflections, public values have only a minor role in dominant reforms. An external orientation, a true public service motivation, was hardly encouraged by the reforms in the last decades, according to me. But we can discuss. So the third point, last point, the negative impact of reform. I'm not just saying that the reforms neglected a public service motivation and the real role for civil society. I will now argue that it even has a negative effect on that role of civil society. That's the last point I want to make. You know? This is what I saw last week in the United States newspaper. The endless urge to reform Washington. Landmark commissions aimed at making government work better come and go, typically expiring with little follow-up. We need to reform the way we reform. So now we're not just reforming government, but we are reforming the way we reform government. You know? It's all about reform. Reform, reform, reform. with the most magnificent aims and goals. Make government work better. Save money. Address pressing problems. Strengthen and to create better society, they say. Achieving good governance, reinvent government, engage public sector clients, reduce corruption, enforce cooperation. Whatever, whatever, whatever. You know, it's like my daughter.